Thank you. The next item of business is a debate on motion 12331 in the name of Marie Todd on National Care Service Scotland Bill at stage one. I would invite all those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak button. I note that we seem to be missing a committee convener, but hopefully he may appear very shortly indeed, because he's on at number three. And with that, I call on Marie Todd Minister to speak to and to move the motion up to 9 minutes, please.
Thanks very much, Presiding Officer. I'd like to start by thanking everyone who has contributed to the consultation on the National Care Service, our co-design sessions, the annual forums, and the many meetings my officials and I have undertaken. We've heard from thousands of people, and overwhelmingly, the message is the same. We need to improve the social care and community health system across Scotland. We need long-term, widespread transformation to fix some of the ingrained issues within the system and ensure sustainability for the future. This bill is our chance to effect the meaningful change that we all agree is needed. The National Care Service will provide greater transparency of the delivery of care, improve standards, support an improvement in pay and conditions for workers, and provide better support for unpaid carers. I want to thank the seven parliamentary committees who took evidence and reported on the bill during stage one. The committee scrutiny has been comprehensive and robust, which I welcome. I acknowledge that the Health and Social Care and Sport Committee have restated their intention to consider further detail of the Scottish Government's proposed changes to the bill during stage two. I've provided a great deal of information already at stage one in the interests of being transparent and helpful, and have committed to giving the lead committee what it requires during the stage two process as requested in their letter of 7th November, and I repeat that commitment here today. Information will be provided as soon as possible. The starting point for this work was the independent review of adult social care conducted by Derek Feely that was commissioned by government in summer of 2020. It's been the guiding force behind this bill. It recommended reforming social care in Scotland and strengthening national accountability for social care support. It outlined the limitations of our current delivery structures. These included a postcode lottery of user experience, a lack of national oversight and coordination, and the lack of collaborative and strategic leadership. It also said that we should take a human rights-based approach to social care. All of this has been confirmed through our engagement and our co-design work. We've heard repeatedly that the current social care and community healthcare system must change to drive up standards to a consistent level across the country. Now, many campaigners have been waiting a long time for this, but some don't have a long time. And I know from listening to them that the status quo is not an option, that we cannot delay change. I was very moved to meet an advocate for motor neurone disease recently. He told his story powerfully. He may only have a few months to live, too few to be spending time as a delayed discharge in ICU when he could be at home with his family. Now, as a country, we should be good enough at planning, managing, and delivering social care so that people like him get exactly what they need, when and where they need it. Now, Feely also highlighted a need to reconsider the way that we think about social care. Globally, social care support is seen as a burden or a drain on society. Now, in a country with an ageing population, with unprecedented pressure on our National Health Service, we can't afford to view social care as a burden. It's an investment in our society. Good social care, wherever people live in Scotland and whatever their needs are, enables and empowers people to live independent lives. Certainly.
Pam Duncan-Clancy.
I thank the Minister for taking that intervention. And I have to say, as a disabled person and a user of social care, and also someone who gets a lot of representations through my inbox, as many of us do, these things have been said to people who use social care for decades. For a decade, this government has promised people who use social care that they would get more access to it, that they wouldn't have to pay for it, that there would be care workers there to provide it when they need it, and still there isn't any. So can I ask, without any detail of this in the bill, how can the government expect people to believe them this time?
Minister.
So I agree that there is a great deal of time that people have waited for this change. But let me assure you and let me assure the public that this change is coming. I think that over the past 10 years and longer, we have established that primary legislation and structural change is required. There are parties in this Parliament who still oppose that idea. And I think I absolutely agree with Pam Duncan Glancy that it is unequivocal that we need change. Yeah. Now, we will deliver change, and I am keen to work with everyone across this Parliament to deliver the change that Scotland needs and deserves. The bill, as introduced, sets out the principles of a national care service. It commits to a national care service charter. It sets out a national approach to managing complaints. It sets out provisions relating to data sharing and to care records. It includes provision for breaks for carers, and it includes provision to enact Anne's Law so that people in care homes have the rights to be visited by their families. The engagement that we have carried out over the past year reconfirms that all those provisions are essential to improving social care in Scotland, and they remain central to the government's planned approach. Now, as I've set out in some detail to the committees and in information I have shared with all members across this chamber this week, there are three significant changes that I intend to make to the bill at stage two, should Parliament agree to the general principles of the bill today. These changes are in response to evidence taken at stage one following engagement with COSLA and the NHS and responding to ongoing feedback from stakeholders. The main changes I want to make to the NCS bill at stage two are that a National Care Service Board will be established to oversee delivery across Scotland, that we'll not create new local care boards as originally planned, but will instead reform existing integration authorities, and that local authorities will retain responsibility for current functions and the delivery of social work and social care services with no transfer of staff or assets. Now, this change of approach reflects the challenges of a new fiscal environment where it is more important than ever that we demonstrate value for money. These changes would substantively reduce the cost of the bill by removing the need to set up care boards and to transfer staff and assets. And as I set out to the Finance Committee, this will mean that the costs of setting up the National Care Service will be up to £345 million over 10 years, where the proposal set out in the bill as introduced would have cost £1.6 billion over the same period. Now, we collectively spend over £5 billion a year on social care provision. The costs of change would be under 1% of that current spend. We can make meaningful, lasting change for that relatively modest amount. Now, in relation to children's social care, social work and community health services, the National Care Service will bring change. We have a real opportunity to improve the outcomes for children and families. The NCS can help to simplify the currently complex landscape for children and lay the foundations to deliver much needed improvement. I want to set out the difference that I believe the National Care Service Board will make. The board will include, as a minimum, an independent chair, Scottish Government, local government, the NHS, and people with lived experience of receiving and delivering community health and social care. The board will have an overview of planning and delivery of community health and social care provision across all of Scotland. It'll look at what's spent, what care is provided, who receives it, and the outcomes for those people. The Board will also have a support and improvement framework to drive improvement and innovation and to help local areas when monitoring indicates that standards and needs are not being met, and to intervene if necessary. The National Board will give us a level of transparency that is not possible in the current system. It will let us understand where people's experiences are inconsistent across Scotland, build on good practice, and tackle challenges. And it will reflect the approach we have already taken to building the National Care Service by ensuring that we listen to the voices of the real experts,
The Minister's about to conclude.
The people who use community health and social care, their unpaid carers and the staff who provide it. Now, in concluding, I want to repeat that the status quo is not an option. We must make change and invest in the future. The NCS is our vehicle to do that, and I can believe it can make a real difference to those who so urgently need the change. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister. I now call on Claire Hockey on behalf of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee. Up to 8 minutes, please, Ms Hockey.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I refer members to my register of interest in that I hold a bank staff nurse contract with NHS Greater Glasgow and Clyde. And can I begin by thanking the committee clerks for their support during the committee's inquiry and preparation of the committee's Stage 1 report. The Health and Social Care and Sport Committee began its Stage 1 scrutiny of the National Care Service Scotland Bill in October 2022, having issued a call for evidence during the summer. There was extensive engagement with that initial call for evidence, and I'd like to start by thanking everyone who contributed. The committee has listened very carefully to all the views expressed through that process, and they have been invaluable in forming the committee's recommendations. The committee took oral evidence on the bill over 9 meetings between October and December 2022, and we took further evidence on the bill in May 2023 and then during 3 meetings in October 2023. And I'm equally grateful to everyone who contributed oral evidence to the committee over that time. One message we heard very strongly throughout our scrutiny was the case for reform in social care. That reform is badly needed. To address existing inconsistencies in access, to ensure consistent application of guidance and legislation, to address ongoing challenges in the social care workforce, to improve commissioning and procurement of services, and most importantly of all, to improve outcomes for those receiving social care and support. The case for reform is what motivated Derek Feely's independent review of adult social care to recommend the creation of a National Care Service. And in responding to the Feely report, the Scottish Government has sought to give those with lived experience a stronger voice in shaping those proposals through a process of co-design. One of those giving oral evidence to the committee described this as a bold approach. At the same time, the committee has heard many stakeholders raising concern about an ongoing lack of clarity regarding the definition, the precise scope, and the key areas of focus of co-design and the anticipated outcomes of the co-design process. In a recommendation unanimously supported by members, the committee's report calls on the Scottish Government to set out an overarching plan that includes a clear definition of co-design, parameters and intended outcomes of the co-design work, and a timetable for its completion. And we also want the Scottish Government to recognise the critical role the Scottish Parliament has to play in undertaking ongoing scrutiny of the Bill's implementation, including in relation to the outcomes of the co-design process. During its scrutiny, the committee heard widespread support for the principles set out in Section 1 of the Bill. At the same time, our report highlights several areas where a majority of the committee believe these principles could be usefully clarified and strengthened. While acknowledging the Scottish Government's stated commitment to fair work principles, a majority of the committee would like to see the bill strengthened to include a clear and comprehensive definition of fair work and clarity on how those principles will be consistently applied and enforced. The committee's report seeks clarification on the remit of the planned National Social Work Agency. The Scottish Government has said the agency's responsibilities will include monitoring and improving service quality, overseeing and supporting education, improving and scaling up good practice, workforce planning, training and development, and terms and conditions, including pay. The committee is keen to understand why its proposed remit is limited to the social work profession when there is an equally pressing need to address these issues for the wider social care workforce. Further, it is said if it is to be set up as a department within the Scottish Government, how it will be ensured that it has the necessary operational independence to fulfil its role effectively. And I look forward to receiving a considered response to these concerns from the Minister. On health and social care information, we have been talking about the creation of a single electronic health and care record for a long time. Completing that work will be fundamental to the success of the proposed National Care Service and needs to be treated as an absolute priority. The committee's report also highlights the importance of monitoring and evaluation. Without it, how can we judge whether a National Care Service has successfully achieved its objectives? The committee has unanimously called for appropriate provision to be made for effective monitoring and evaluation of the proposed National Care Service on the face of the bill. I acknowledge there have been many areas where the committee has been unable to reach a consensus position, but I'm pleased to note that our recommendations on those parts of the bill relating to creating a right to breaks for carers and to implementing Anne's Law were unanimously supported. These are important measures that I hope can be implemented with all due care and speed. Clearly, the Scottish Government's overall approach to this legislation has shifted significantly since the bill was introduced in June 2022.
Monica Lennon.
To Claire Hawkey for giving me a thank the convener. I'm glad she mentioned Anne's Law, and I welcome the recommendations at 81 and 82 in the report. I note that the committee agreed that Anne's Law should be fully implemented as soon as possible to ensure a human rights-based approach to care. Were there different options other than just this bill looked at by the committee? Because I think there is a frustration across the chamber that we all agree on Anne's Law, but perhaps doesn't need to be part of this bill. It could be implemented in other ways.
Claire Hawkey.
So the committee was considering the bill in its entirety with all the different parts, and one of those sections was Anne's Law. The consensus agreement with COSLA on shared legal accountability means a number of key aspects of the bill will need to change. Accountability for social care will no longer be transferred from local authorities to Scottish ministers. Integration joint boards will no longer be replaced by local care boards. Instead, a National Care Service Board is proposed, and local government will now retain social care functions, staff and assets. While this shift is an approach may be welcomed by many, we need to acknowledge that others will have been left feeling disappointed that it fails to reflect the core aspirations of the Feeley Review. For those people, there will be a job to be done to rebuild that trust. Our committee has noted the Scottish Government's intention to bring about changes to the bill through amendments at Stage 2. A majority of the committee has expressed a willingness to recommend that the general principles of the bill as introduced should be approved at Stage 1. However, we have made the majority recommendation on the understanding that the Scottish Government is prepared to allow the committee sufficient time to take further oral and written evidence on the details of those amendments prior to commencing the formal stage of considering and disposing of amendments at Stage 2. I want to acknowledge the interim response received from the Minister yesterday, and I'm grateful to the Minister for providing the committee with a summary target operating model for the proposed National Care Service. The Minister has also given a commitment that she will formalise the extensive input so far received from a wide range of stakeholders into a legislative advisory group to help guide the ongoing development of the bill. A majority of the committee has specifically called for the full text of the Scottish Government's Stage 2 amendments, a marked-up version of the bill as introduced, incorporating those amendments in a highlighted format, and an updated policy memorandum and explanatory notes to be published no later than the 29th of March. I am particularly encouraged by the Minister's commitment in our interim response to accept this recommendation and to facilitate what the committee requires to do this as quickly as possible. In conclusion, I look forward to listening to all the contributions to this afternoon's debate. I acknowledge that it ultimately wasn't possible to reach a consensus position as a committee on the general principles of the bill. I recognise the strongly held positions of all members on the committee and across the chamber. However, if later today the Parliament agrees to approve the general principles of the Bill at Stage 1, as the majority of the committee has recommended, I hope that all members, whatever their view they express today, will continue to engage constructively with a reinforced process of scrutiny at Stage 2.
Thank you, Ms Hockey. I now call on Kenneth Gibson on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee. Up to 4 minutes, please, Mr Gibson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. And I first wish to apologise for missing the first minute of the Minister's opening speech. I would also like to confer my own thanks to the clerking team of the Finance and Public Administration Committee, who have been very strong in their support of our deliberations. And following on from Claire Hockey, I would say that we did actually reach consensus on our committee in terms of the deliberations which I'm about to discuss. So I'm pleased to contribute to this debate on behalf of the Finance and Public Administration Committee and highlight the key issues we identified during scrutiny of the financial memorandum for the Bill. The committee examined the costs associated with the National Care Service Bill and programme and first reported on the FM in December 2022. A report raised, and I quote, significant concerns in relation to the costings within the financial memorandum, which we considered, I quote again, did not provide best estimates of the cost the bill gives rise to. We requested a revised financial memorandum, including full details of the underlying assumptions, updated estimates for the gaps identified in this report, as well as updates to the existing cost estimates set out in the FM. Last December, the Minister provided an updated FM along with a summary of the financial implications of changes proposed to the Bill following agreement between COSLA and the Scottish Government on shared accountability for the NCS as well as a programme business case. We took further evidence from the Bill team and Minister on the 23rd and 25th of January respectively, setting out our conclusions in a letter to the Scottish Government on the 8th of February. The changes proposed by the Scottish Government remove a number of the uncertainties we originally highlighted, including around the transfer of staff and assets and the number of care boards. It also extends the timeline for implementation over a 10-year period. The original FM presented costs ranging from £644 million to £1,260 million over a period of 5 years. The updated FM, based on the Bill proposals as introduced, estimates the costs of £880 million to £2,192 million over a period of a decade. Under revised proposals to be introduced by amendment at Stage 2, total costs over a 10-year period fall dramatically to between £631 million and £916 million, substantially lower than in the original and updated FM. The committee has acknowledged the work undertaken to improve cost estimates associated with the Bill since we published a report on the original FM back in December 2022. This includes narrowing the variances between the lower and upper cost ranges and enhancing the level of detail regarding the costs associated with the rights to breaks for unpaid carers, which now form the bulk of the proposed expenditure. The reduction in the maximum cost variance from 225% to 45%, comparing the 10-year costings of the new FM with the original, is a welcome indicator of the work to provide more accurate and lower costs. Nevertheless, the FPA committee has concerns regarding the approach taken by the Scottish Government to introduce a framework bill and use co-design to develop the detail of the policy as the bill progresses through Parliament. We prefer co-design to be undertaken as early as possible to enable inclusion in primary legislation. Had this committee accepted the original financial memorandum, it would have led to significant unnecessary expense to the public purse at a time of severe strain on Scotland's public finances. As we explored during evidence, some risks and uncertainty around costings remain, namely the potential of VAT liability should direct funding be provided to the integration authorities, costs associated with the proposals for information sharing or the creation of an integrated health and social care record, the format, functions and membership of the National Care Board, and the yet unknown level of unmet need that the NCS will need to address. We heard evidence that the co-design process continues to support development of the policy detail to be included in secondary legislation after the bill is passed, and that business cases are being developed to support this work. We welcome the Scottish Government's intention to share these with the committee, along with associated costs. We are concerned at the piecemeal nature of providing updates in different formats, which is not conducive to effective parliamentary scrutiny. Presiding Officer, we will continue to monitor the finances associated with the bill and take this opportunity to reiterate our own request to the Scottish Government that the committee is kept updated of all costs related to the bill and the programme as they progress. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Gibson. I now call on Sandesh Gulhani. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you. I wish to refer members to my register of interest as a practising NHS GP, and I'm also a member of Parliament's Health, Social Care and Sport Committee. Despite warnings that the SNP Green government is unable to articulate and communicate how the National Care Service would actually work in practice, Parliament is nevertheless asked today to support a bill on the basis that, come the second reading, all will be revealed. Really? Well, that's not how scrutiny of legislation is supposed to work. We're not here to give the government the benefit of the doubt. I know the islanders of Arran wouldn't, nor those using the A9, nor patients waiting for cancer treatment. The Law Society of Scotland is also concerned about the bill as presented. It says effective scrutiny is a crucial element of the creation of good law. It is therefore essential that there be further clarity in both policy and drafting terms at an early stage to allow for proper scrutiny and appropriate stakeholder engagement. And I'm mindful of other flagship bills this SNP Green coalition has tried to push through Parliament over the past couple of years. And here we go again. When it comes to the latest SNP rebrand of the National Care Service Bill, health committee members are well aware that there is a dearth of detail and so many unanswered questions. This bill is far from ready for a stage one vote. There's criticism from professional organisations, unions, charities and councils. All four members of the committee who are not SNP or Green dissented from up to 46 of the 110-point recommendations, including support for the bill's general principles. These so-called principles are so broadly drawn that it's not clear who the principles apply to, the accountability and enforcement, how these principles will be evaluated, or how they'll fit with existing rights under the 2010 Equality Act. We all know how important this is. Least legislation goes pear-shaped. The SNP Green government argues that we were asked to approve a framework bill, that much of the detail will be set out in secondary legislation, that they are simply trying to work at pace and be efficient. But the many areas we highlight should be addressed in primary legislation. The Law Society of Scotland's view is this is not inconsistent with the aim of ensuring responsiveness and adaptability. Furthermore, the approach whereby the bill is scrutinised in advance of the co-design process, this limits our committee's job to provide full and effective scrutiny at this stage of primary legislation, as important details are simply not available. And while we're going on the subject of co-creation, the SNP Green government's approach is highly problematic. There is no statutory basis for this co-design process within the bill and no statutory guarantee for meaningful engagement from a full range of stakeholders. There are many understandings of co-design, but we don't know what the SNP Green government has in mind, nor do we have a plan on how it intends to go about this. And this might suit a government that has a reputation for secrecy and, according to some of its own members, authoritarianism. Scottish ministers will be responsible for the National Care Service in a way that seems to them to best reflect the National Care Service principles. Despite shared legal responsibility with COSLA, Scottish ministers are responsible for monitoring and improvement of services with significant discretion afforded to Scottish ministers. We all agree that social care reform is well overdue, and the Scottish Conservatives support key recommendations of the Fee Leave Review, including national employment conditions for staff and treating social care as an equal partner to the NHS. But rather than opt for a centralised, top-down approach to care as advocated by the SNP, we believe there could be many approaches that are tailored to those needing support and doing now, as Monica Lennon suggested earlier. This can include caring for people with a terminal illness, many of whom are spending their end-of-life journey at home. By 2040, 60,000 Scots will have palliative care needs, 10,000 more than today. We need to ensure that everyone in Scotland has a right to the palliative care that they need. The SNP Green Coalition is bent on centralising social care at the expense of local authorities. All the hallmarks of a power grab that will not improve social care delivery. And it's an expensive power grab at that. Parliament's Finance Committee has repeatedly raised concerns about how this will all be funded, that costings did not and could not reflect the actual cost of the provision of the bill, but instead the SNP government decided to plough ahead with their failed scheme, ignoring the concern of experts. The SNP Green government are spending over £800,000 every month on civil servants for the National Care Service already. To get a National Care Service up and running, we were told by the Social Care Minister, Marie Todd, to expect total spend of £1.6 billion, now less, still almost a billion. The type of National Care Service advocated is the wrong priority for Scotland. Where are the efforts to eliminate delayed discharge promised by Shona Robison by the end of 2015? Yes, you heard right, 2015. As the Royal College of Physicians of Edinburgh reports, in the year ending March 2023, there were over 660,000 days spent in hospital by people whose discharge was delayed because they did not have a social care package to support them at home. And there's a double whammy. Scottish Care has warned that one care home per week is closing in Scotland. We now have 19% less care homes than in 2013, with private care homes being cheaper for the public purse. Humza Yousaf is the mastermind who drafted the National Care Services Bill in June 22, with a plan to complete stage one by March 23. The fact is, the NCS Bill has been delayed 4 times. It had to be radically overhauled and implementation postponed until 2029. But just yesterday and today, Minister Marie Todd tried to tell us that she was going to prevent delay. The SNP Green Coalition is making up the timelines as it goes along. If it was about scrutiny, we would have everything with us already. And we need to ensure that the enormous challenges faced by patients, both young and old, are garnished and looked after today. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Gohani. I now call on Jackie Bailey. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Social care is in crisis right now. Care packages for some of our most vulnerable people are being cut. Almost 10,000 people are stuck waiting on assessments and to receive care, and providers are handing back contracts because they can't afford to deliver. Staff morale is at rock bottom, with people leaving the profession in droves. Nothing in this bill addresses that immediate crisis. Instead, we have a framework bill with little detail, introduced 20 months ago, and despite the Minister's warm words, implementation will not happen until 28-29 at a projected cost of £2.2 billion. Not one penny will go towards care packages right now, and nothing either for hard-pressed social care staff. This bill should have been about raising standards and the quality of care. It should have been about removing care charges. It should have been about standardising eligibility criteria, encouraging independent living, valuing the workforce with consistent terms and conditions, collective bargaining and pay. And it should have been about cultural change, not just structural change. A framework bill with little detail that has frustrated stakeholders and frustrated Parliament, described by many as a bill without vision, a bill that simply doesn't address the challenges now, and a bill without ambition. The bill as introduced has been considered by numerous committees, health and social care, education, finance, delegated powers, local government, more besides. Concerns have been expressed by the overwhelming majority of them, and indeed the finance committee, as we've heard earlier, have looked at it twice and still don't believe the sums actually add up. And they are not alone. The voluntary sector, the independent sector, carers, those experiencing care, trade unions, all of them have concerns. And if you look at the committee report, it runs to more pages than there are clauses of the bill, and page after page is filled with criticism. Now, I'm not going to rehearse the arguments made yesterday about further scrutiny, but it is really simple. The bill as introduced is about to change beyond recognition because of a deal done with COSLA. It has simply not been scrutinised. The SNP and the Greens don't care about the integrity of this Parliament. They want to ride roughshod over the legislative-making process and just railroad this bill through. It's a mess, and this is a recipe for bad legislation. But let me consider a few of the provisions that we do support. Anne's Law and the right to respite breaks. We support Anne's Law 100%. The right for relatives to see their loved ones in care homes must be legislated for. We cannot repeat the heartbreaking experience of too many families during COVID. The current provisions in the bill are weak, but there is a strong argument to decouple this from the bill. You could, and I invite the Minister to look at this, amend the Social Care and Social Work Improvement Scotland Requirements for Care Services Regulations of 2011. This would be a much faster legislative vehicle, which would undoubtedly carry the unanimous support of this Parliament. We also support the right to respite 100%. But again, there are other legislative opportunities that can be explored. But the truth is, this element will take resources. The financial memorandum estimates that the amount of additional money required for 2025 is £5 million, rising to £133 million in 2035. But that's just for 10% of carers. This is fantasy budgeting. And like so much the SNP do, this legislation might be passed, but it will not be enacted. And carers are let down in the process. Let me turn to social care staff, because they're the backbone of the delivery of quality social care. Yet they are leaving their jobs. They're going to work in Lidl or Asda because they pay more. We first proposed £12 per hour in early 2021, rising to £15 by the end of the Parliament. Had the government done so then, the hourly rate now would be worth £14.43, and you wouldn't have the hemorrhage of social care staff. It's regretfully always the same with this SNP government. They talk a good game, but they fail to deliver. So where are the Fair Work principles in the bill? The improved terms and conditions, the right to full sick pay from day one, the opportunity for sectoral bargaining. They are simply not there. The Daily Record today outlines the pressure that social care workers are under. Quoting a recent GMB survey of frontline care workers in Glasgow, 80% of them said social care staff believe workloads are now unmanageable. 89% are warning that vulnerable service users are now at risk. One carer said, "We are rushing from one visit to another, always chasing our tail, never being allowed to give enough time to people. I used to absolutely love my job, but I'm terrified someone is going to be so rushed they make a terrible mistake. I just want to get out before it's me." The National Care Service Bill will do nothing to address these problems. Nothing for those whose care packages are being cut now. Nothing to help the sector, which is on its knees. And nothing to stem the flood of staff leaving. It was, of course, Scottish Labour that proposed a National Care Service more than a decade ago, but the SNP said no. The bill as it stands does not implement the Feely Review. It will not work as it stands. We will continue to engage constructively at stage two, but it must be lengthened to allow for proper scrutiny. There is no room for arrogance or hubris in something this important, and I fear that instead of listening to the many reasonable suggestions from stakeholders, the government is now hard of hearing. Please don't ignore the warnings from those with care experience. Don't ignore them from social care staff. Don't ignore them from social workers or the sector as a whole. This bill must not be an excuse for the SNP not to act now to avert a crisis in social care. Stop the cuts to care, boost pay in the sector, and deliver a right to breaks and Anne's Law so that those can deliver for those who work, live and care in our social care system. Finally, we reluctantly cannot support the general principles of the bill. The committee has not scrutinised the substantial changes that are being made, but we will continue to engage constructively at stage two.
Thank you, Ms Bailey. I now call on Alex Cole-Hamilton. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. Here we are again, debating this afternoon another iteration of what was in essence a line in the SNP's manifesto in 2021. This was an election 3 years ago, and we are here again with another amorphous form looking for a function. I will come on to that again. A lot yesterday in the debate around Jackie Bailey's motion to defer this proceeding, focused from government benches by evoking the National Health Service and establishing the National Health Service. I'm gratified that hasn't happened so far today. I dare say it might. But the rhetoric would suggest that we are on the threshold of some great reform, that the names of Beveridge, now Bevan, are soon to be joined in the annals of our national story by the likes of Kevin Stewart and Marie Todd. But we aren't on the edge of a great reform. This is an amorphous structure, an ever-changing structure, looking for a role in our society. And all we've heard from opposition, rightly so heard from people like Jackie Bailey and Sandesh Gulhani, is that it is still to find that role in our society. I've heard the Minister suggest that the Liberal Democrats, in our staunch opposition to this bill, to the establishment of the National Care Service, would so too be in opposition to the National Health Service, where we all transported back to 1948. But you will recall, Presiding Officer, that whilst the vision for the NHS was executed by a Labour parliamentarian, it was the brainchild of a Liberal parliamentarian in William Beveridge. When William Beveridge wrote the Beveridge report, he identified five great evils in our society: ignorance, idleness, squalor, want and disease. And it was that last one he felt most important in terms of establishing a basis on which we had equal access to healthcare, healthcare that was free at the point of delivery and readily available in every community of this country. But that has, in terms of the National Care Service, that's where the nomenclature is where the similarities end. Because we know that whilst it is actually a function looking for a form looking for a function, so no lives will be saved in its creation. Nobody who didn't get free care yesterday will get it on the implementation and royal assent of this bill. No care workers will be paid any more as a result of it, but we will be paying the cost of it through the taxpayer purse. There are significant concerns about this bill on the part of stakeholders and indeed the committee. We've heard some of that today. The committee report on this bill has been damning. The word concerns features 28 times in the summary alone. Presiding Officer, around 238,000 people receive social care support in Scotland. Many of them will be known to us in this chamber. Many of them will be related to us in this chamber. That is 4% of our population. This is a vital and important part of our society. Those who work in it, manage the sector, are clear it needs to be better funded. And of course it needs reform, but they're not talking about the ministerial paragraph of centralisation that line the pages of this piece of legislation. Don't take my word for it. Listen to Cosler, who just this week said, and I quote, "The reality is that national funding decisions will further squeeze local care and social work services, which are already under incredible pressure." And indeed, Cosler put out a briefing this afternoon saying, despite the agreement they have come to with government, they still harbour significant reservations, particularly in the nature of the funding settlement they have been meted with this week. Instead of providing that support, Presiding Officer, the government has delivered a hammer blow to local authorities in their budget. It's hard to imagine a worse plan for social care than the one which is before us today, or a worse time for its execution than the time we are in now. It is a bureaucratic exercise that will cost large sums of money and consume vast amounts of time. Right from the start, there have been serious concerns about its skyrocketing costs, which could reach over £2 billion, and the design process. Each and every iteration of the bill has proved outrageously expensive and completely unworkable. That's why we keep having to go back to the drawing board. That's why this government has deferred it and deferred it again. Care organisations, unions, local authorities have united to condemn it. Even SNP Finance Committee members have suggested that the sums do not add up. And there are still hesitations and concerns within that committee. It's no wonder this legislation has been pushed back three times. And I put it to you, Presiding Officer, we're only here because we are running out of parliamentary time for the SNP to deliver on their flagship manifesto commitment before we rise for the next Scottish parliamentary elections. That is why we're here today. Presiding Officer, just when the sector needs clarity, support, the government has embarked on a grand bureaucratic crusade which is characterised by confusion and chaos. It is form looking for a function. Scottish Liberal Democrats have always rejected plans for a ministerial takeover of social care. We always will. We firmly believe that local authorities, care providers, those on the front lines, are best placed to make decisions about how to implement, how to structure the care in their community. We believe that power works best when it's closest as possible to the people it is there to serve. But there is yet more confusion around just what powers ministers would be given as part of these plans, with the committee report saying that, I quote, it remains unclear to what extent Scottish ministers will have extensive powers with respect to the proposed National Care Service Board. The government is all over the place here. Right from the start, things have not been done properly. The committee said that one of its challenges with this bill is, and I quote again, the lack of available detail from the start of our scrutiny. And only this morning, the minister circulated a target operating model for the National Care Service. This has been something we have been waiting for a long time. On the day this is introduced to Parliament, that we are expected to vote on its general principles, we are given this. It simply is not the way we should do things. We are now forced to waste our time voting on a hollow-out nothing burger of a bill that does zero to address the very real issues in social care, which no one on the front lines wanted in the first place. It will not make care free at the point of delivery. It will not make care a profession of choice. And it will not relieve the interruption in flow that currently is causing a crisis in our NHS, because people cannot be released from hospital because there is no adequate provision in our communities to receive them. Free up the funds of this £1 billion bureaucracy. Scrap your bill today and use that money to improve the pay and working conditions of our social care staff, whose selfless and quiet, heroic efforts often go unnoticed and rewarded.
Mr. Hamilton, you'll need to conclude.
This is what we should be focusing on today, presiding officer, not this ill-fated, bureaucratic waste of time. Thank you,
Mr. Hamilton. We now move to the open debate and backbench speeches of up to 6 minutes. I call Emma Harper to be followed by Liz Smith. Ms. Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a member of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee, who has been present during the entirety of the committee scrutiny of the bill and during the Stage 1 report, I do welcome that this bill is at Stage 1 today. And I'd like to thank everyone involved in providing evidence, and for the clerks also, and of course anyone who provides care for our people across Scotland. What we have to remember with this bill is that it is about a change which may be described as monumental, as the creation of the National Health Service was a framework legislation as well as this legislation. So we need to remember that. And I want to be clear that the evidence that we've taken at committee has clearly demonstrated that the current social care landscape is cluttered, is complex, and that it's fundamentally, it isn't working for those requiring care who are some of the most vulnerable people in our society. This Parliament has a duty, therefore, to those individuals to get this bill right and to have a social care system which meets the demand of our society, but which is underpinned by the principles of human rights, respect and person-centred choices. Presiding Officer, there is a need for standardisation of the social care system, employment practices, education for social care workers and of social care standards across all of Scotland. And from evidence, it is clear that yes, sure, I will.
Julie Mackay.
I thank Emma Harper for taking an intervention. Would she agree that as part of that, we also have to look at self-directed support and how that's delivered across the country as well, and make sure that when we're looking at the National Care Service as a whole, it's not just directly delivered services, but self-directed support too?
Emma Harper.
Absolutely. I thank Gillian Mackay for that intervention. I am coming on to self-directed support, but I think that is part of all of this complexity that needs to be reformed so that we can make changes and help support our most vulnerable people that need care. So thank you for that. From the evidence, it is clear that one of the best ways to do the changes is through reform and integration of joint boards, as the Minister has set out to the committee. And at committee, we have heard repeatedly from people with lived experience that the current adult social care system must change in order to drive up standards to a consistent level across our country. One of the ways it is intended that these aims be met is through the creation of a National Care Service Board. And the NCS Board will ensure that there exists consistent, fair, human rights-based social care support and community health services in place. The NCS Board will be responsible for reviewing and overseeing the performance of local strategic plans. And to support this, the Scottish Government is proposing to transfer ministerial powers of intervention to the Board. This will allow the Board to invoke these powers as a last resort, and it gives the levers needed to drive and support performance and act if required. As a former clinical educator and a nurse, I am really interested in how this board will help to standardise social care and social working care, how we approach it across the whole of Scotland. Just this week, my office spoke with a local care provider across Dumfries and Galloway about the NCS board and the standardisation. They welcomed this approach. At Stewartry Care, they were one of the folk that gave us evidence when we visited Dumfries. My office called them the other day. They're one of the largest providers of social care across Dumfries and Galloway. And they stated that although they carry out mandatory moving and handling training for their staff, much of the training they do on top of this is not mandatory. And Stewartry Care also trains staff on assessment of nutritional status, and their staff are given education on how to spot the signs and symptoms of malnutrition of those within their care. However, it was evident, as from the meeting with Food and Food Train last week, that this kind of education is not a universal practice. And many care providers don't have this education or training, despite the importance of nutrition and the commitments in the Good Food Nation Act passed by this Parliament. This is just one example of an area of education which would benefit from standardisation across the whole of Scotland. And I would ask whether the Minister agrees with me and that we shall consider nutritional monitoring as being part of the national standards as the bill progresses, not necessarily in primary legislation, but look at how we consider that as we look forward to moving standards forward. Presiding Officer, I also want to touch on the commitment to establishing a national social work agency, which COSLA has agreed with. And for those working in and leading the social work profession, the establishment of a national social work agency is a vital piece in the jigsaw of reform. And as has been noted by Social Work Scotland, the current national arrangements for social work are messy and inefficient, with the Scottish Government, employers, SSSC, Social Work Scotland, improvement bodies and many others, they're all separately leading on aspects of social work's development. But if we are to affect the changes in social work systems and practice outlined by the Independent Review of Social Care and the promise, and which the profession itself has called for, we need to create an enabling context. The National Social Work Agency has a real potential to address these challenges. Currently, in Dumfries and Galloway, social workers are paid the lowest wages than all other Scottish social work departments. That's why some of our social workers, they're leaving to go and work south of the border and to other parts of southern Scotland. So this is something that could be addressed as we take a national agency forward. Another example is that self-directed support, which Gillian Mackay intervened on me about. That's administered with a quite variable approaches by different local authorities, with some performing really well and others performing not so well. So I would ask the Minister to confirm that it is the Scottish Government's intention for the Social Work Agency to deal with these kind of discrepancies, to support the social work profession and get it right for those engaging with social work. So it's clear that this bill is needed to improve social work care and social work landscape in Scotland. So in closing, Presiding Officer, I will be supporting this bill at stage one and urge members to do so. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Harper. I now call Liz Smith to be followed by Ivan McKee. Ms Smith.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. When a major committee of this Parliament concludes that it is concerned that the Scottish Government has so far been unable to articulate and communicate a model of how the proposed new legislation would operate, it is hardly a ringing endorsement. And worse still, when that is supposed to be one of the most important pieces of legislation the Parliament has seen. Because both the Minister, Marie Todd, and First Ministers Nicola Sturgeon and Hamza Youssef argued that the National Care Service Bill was to be a flagship piece of legislation. Indeed, in their words, and I quote, arguably the most important public service reform since the creation of the National Health Service in 1948. Now that is quite a pledge. I don't doubt the Scottish Government's ambition, but in the usual way for legislation, particularly given its flagship nature, we should have had the right to expect a well-thought-out, wholly coherent and well-costed bill. We should also have had the right to expect a fully watertight scrutiny process, giving committees and parliamentarians maximum opportunity to engage in detailed scrutiny. And that has not been the case. It's not the case in terms of the structure of the bill, and it's not the case in terms of the costings, which I'll come to in just a minute. Deputy Presiding Officer, the first iteration of the bill faced very considerable criticism from no fewer than four parliamentary committees: Health and Social Care, Local Government, Audit and Finance. and there was no clarity whatsoever about the related costs, which is why, as Kenny Gibson rightly said, the Finance Committee would not accept the first financial memorandum. And it was also why the DPLR Committee raised concerns. But just as importantly, it also faced very widespread criticism from local authorities and health service stakeholders. In short, it was in deep trouble last summer, including from some SNP MSPs. And given these circumstances, Marie Todd was well told that there had to be a major rethink. So what did we get? Three changes, two very major changes to the bill. There would no longer be any transfer of local authority staff and assets, and there would be no new care boards for each of the 32 local authorities. And accompanying the changes, a second attempt at a financial memorandum was presented, marginally better than the first, but still not satisfying the Finance Committee, as its members have made clear. But there are other issues about parliamentary scrutiny. The Scottish Government has made substantial changes to the accountability and governance provisions in the bill, but it has not provided the detail of what these changes look like in legislation. The Finance Committee has particular concerns about the lack of detail surrounding the new National Care Board. Now, the Minister tells us that the bill is only a framework bill, and she said that she will share the details about governance and accountability provisions should the general principles of the bill be agreed to. That is very unusual territory, and not one that we feel makes for good legislation. Presiding Officer, framework bills have suddenly become quite fashionable in this place. If I was being charitable, this is because of the principle of co-design, i.e. allowing ministers and stakeholders together to design the bill. And I'll come back to that in a minute. But if I was being less charitable, it is because the Scottish Government is finding it impossible, for whatever reason, to produce the detail that Parliament needs. And Presiding Officer, if I may be allowed to say so, as somebody who's been in this place a long time, too many framework bills on the statute books present a problem for scrutiny. And perhaps when the presiding officer looks at parliamentary reform, that is an important issue to consider. Because as Jackie Bailey rightly pointed out, we cannot have bad legislation. The Finance Committee remains very sceptical indeed about the co-design process. Not in its principle, there's lots of good things about co-design, but about the lack of estimates for measuring the economic benefits set against the projected cost, and also about how to measure the co-design cost at all, given that the co-design process is still ongoing. We feel that that co-design process should have been completed before the revised bill was brought to Parliament. And we know that a framework bill has been roundly criticised by stakeholders and parliamentary committees for the lack of detail about what would appear in primary legislation and what might appear in secondary legislation. That isn't good enough, and it's why, during the first iteration of the bill, the committees put their scrutiny concerns on record, with the DPLR committee saying that it was, I thought, actually a very revealing comment from the DPLR committee, that the Scottish Government's approach is, I quote, unacceptable and risks setting a dangerous precedent, undermining the role of Parliament. Let me say that again. Undermining the role of Parliament. I've said before, Deputy Presiding Officer, that I can remember previous occasions when there were issues about financial memoranda. The Children and Young People's Bill and college regionalisation would be two examples, but not ones that are so out of kilter with the ambitions of the bill presented, so lacking in detail and so risky to taxpayers. The Scottish Government, yet again, is guilty of negligence when it comes to the provision of baseline evidence to support the policy basis. And I have to say, one wonders how on earth ministers ended up in this situation.
Thank you, Ms Smith. I call Ivan McKee to be followed by Cara Malkin. Mr McKee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I think everyone agrees the critical importance of this issue. Social care is something that increasingly is a requirement for more and more in society, and that will continue to be so due to demographic changes going forward, and also, of course, its impact on the wider health system as a potential blockage for delayed discharge and many other aspects of the wider system. So it's absolutely critical that we get this correct, and I welcome the government's focus on taking this work forward. The commitment to provide a long-term sustainable solutions to these challenges that we face, not just in Scotland, not just in the UK, but internationally as well, and to build on the work of the Feely review that lays out very clearly the steps that need to be taken. I think that the general principles, I would propose or suggest that everyone can agree with those as articulated in the bill as introduced. The recognition that spending on social care is an investment in society, the need for financial stability, that commitment to fair work, the human rights focus, and the importance of dignity, equality, inclusion, and the commitment to co-design. I think so far everyone can absolutely sign up to that. Unfortunately, the debate on this bill has spent much of its time recently focused on process. But again, I think it's important that we recognise that process is there for good reasons, and it's there to ensure we make good legislation that delivers on the principles clearly articulated in the bill. So it's important to get that right. The Health Committee and other committees has already been recognised, identified uncertainties in the proposals as laid out, with significant changes from the bill as introduced compared to the proposals that have been agreed with the government and COSLA, and the Minister has been articulating over the last months and that are being taken forward in the redesign, the co-design process. So I very much welcome the provision by the Minister and the government of the target operating model that came out in the last 2 days and the fact sheet that's been sent to MSPs alongside that. Sure.
Jackie Bailey.
I mean, I understand that the member himself has been asking for this target operating model for some time now. Does he think it's acceptable that it only appears yesterday when there's no time for committee scrutiny?
Ivan McKee.
We've been asking, as Jackie Bailey identifies, the committee's been asking for this information for a while. I'm glad that it's come out before this debate, and the government, to be fair, made the commitment that it would come out in advance of this debate. We'd always have liked more time for scrutiny, and I'll come on to talk about that as I take my remarks forward. I'm also looking forward to the Scottish Government providing the Stage 2 amendments as asked for by the committee by the 29th of March to enable the committee to take forward Stage 2 scrutiny, an extended Stage 2 scrutiny to meet the timetable laid out. And I'm glad that the Minister has confirmed that those amendments will be coming forward to meet that date during the debate today. I know the government takes this very seriously as a priority, because I understand that the team that's working on this now numbers 160 civil servants, and we've been given assurances by civil servants that there is not a lack of resource working on developing those amendments and taking forward the proposals to thrash out the details of the bill as amended. And that one area I'd just like to focus on briefly is around the finance proposals and the operating model that I've had a look through over the last couple of days, and also the fact sheet that was provided and the responses from the Minister. There's a commitment in there to have a clearer funding model with greater transparency. There's a provision for Ministers and the Board to fund specific activities, local activities, directly in certain circumstances. But I just like clarity from the Minister. That seems to suggest that the bulk of the funding will continue to flow as it does presently. I think it's around £5 billion in total, either through health boards or through local authorities. So I think some clarity on that would be helpful in exactly what is meant by this being providing greater transparency to the funding flows going forward. I think one of the key priorities that is absolutely critical to get right for the whole sector is the pay rates within the sector. The commitment and delivery of the £12 minimum per hour is very welcome, absolutely, and takes everyone to at least the real living wage. It shows that the mechanism was already in place to deliver that in advance of the bill. That increase and future increases towards £15 per hour helps to tackle the major challenges in the sector around about recruitment and retention, notwithstanding, of course, the impact that Brexit has had on immigration restrictions and lack of devolution of immigration to Scotland has had on hampering the sector very, very significantly. But we all recognise that that pay rate and taking forward the wider Fair Work agenda is absolutely critical. But I just want to make one point, that that is not only to the benefit of the staff and those served by within the social care sector. Because of the scale of this sector, any additional pay increases that are delivered to workers within the sector has a wider economic benefit, not just in terms of how that money is spent, but it also drives the labour market and the private sector to increase wages across other sectors as well that suffer, unfortunately, still from low wages. And I would suggest is perhaps one of the most cost-effective ways the government can tackle poverty across society more generally. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I hope that the debate can now move on to issues of substance round about the government's proposals and amendments to the format of the delivery of the National Care Service. I look very much forward to the details of the government amendments, as I do stakeholders do, so they can start to take their positions on that. I look forward to the further evidence that we'll take at stage two in engagement with stakeholders in that regard. And I welcome the government's commitment to supporting the committee and others in this work, because I said at the outset, it's critically important that we get this right to deliver for current generations and, of course, for generations into the future. Thank you very much, Presiding Officer.
I call on Cara Mochan to be followed by Kevin Stewart. Ms Mochan.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wish to thank the clerks and members for their participation in this process. The establishment of a National Care Service gives this Parliament the chance to be bold, ambitious and innovative. Members should take this opportunity and indeed the responsibility that comes with it seriously and act in a way our constituents would expect. That is to read the report, act with conscience and truly decide whether this bill should progress to the next stage. I must say that I am extremely disappointed by the government's approach to the progression of social care, but definitely the progression of the National Care Service. Disappointed in their unwillingness to cooperate and disappointed in their inability to work with people to enhance this crucial piece of legislation. The Minister's contribution at the start of this debate is not based on the reality of the last 10 years. When it was clear that this bill was not ready to proceed, a view I am sure held by many SNP members on the committee, the Scottish Government pushed them to carry on and progress this bill. Indeed, again last night, pushed to vote against, sensibly referring the bill back to the committee. And I think the contribution from the member before me shows that some people on the committee are considering the points in hand, and I hope that we can, if it moves to stage two, work together, and I mean that quite genuinely. The opportunity to improve this bill, to extend stage one and to take more time was made available to committee by Labour members, and the report confirms that. But the SNP and the Green members did not take that opportunity, sadly. Indeed, they pushed through a report that includes a Scottish Government and COSLA deal that was not properly scrutinised, that agrees general principles that have changed significantly to those initially set out, and a report that is laden, absolutely laden, with requests for more evidence, further information. Anyone who reads the report will see that. Suggestions that this report or the evidence within it portray a positive outlook on this government's approach is absolutely absurd. Trade unions, third sector organisations, carers and those who receive care came to committee and to members individually to express serious concerns about the way this bill was progressing, about the framework nature, about the lack of clarity, about the things that could ultimately be done now. But the SNP ignored it and they are pushing on anyway. Ros Foyer, when speaking about the commissioning service this bill proposed to set up, said, and I quote, "Our fear is that the sort of commissioning system that is being set up will neither address nor take forward Fair Work and collective bargaining issues in a way that gives us any surety." Indeed, Presiding Officer, after many steps taken by government were ignored, the co-design process, Rachel Cackett from CCPS summed up well the feeling many hold when she said, and I quote, "There is not, in my view, a great sense that there is a clear connection between what is being heard and what is being delivered through the bill." These are quotes from the STUC and the CCPS. If the government is not listening to them, then many will be asking, who are they actually listening to? They have been irresponsible at a time of critical importance. They have played games with a crucial bill. A national care service is something that Labour has been calling on for years, because if delivered properly, it will deliver that much needed parity between health and social care. Deliver for workers, deliver for carers, deliver for service users. But the Scottish Government, if it continues in its current direction, makes that proper and effective delivery highly unlikely. It is certainly not clear in this bill how they will deliver on those aims. The Scottish Government would have the public believe that to deliver Anne's Law, for example, you need a national care service. And it's those of us fighting to improve the bill to deliver its full potential that the national service is needed. This could not be further from reality. This is the government with a distant relationship with delivery, a government that sat on its hands rather than deliver key policies. Anne's Law could be delivered, and I ask the Minister to address the question raised by my colleague Monica Lennon and be clear that they will be looking to ensure Anne's Law is considered in other legislation as soon as possible. This would be supported across the benches. Throughout the committee process, my colleague Paul Sweeney and I called an expert advisory board, something that is not uncommon. This was rejected by the SNP. We called on the government to bring forward its amendments before the conclusion of stage one to ensure proper scrutiny, rejected by the SNP, and we called on the bill to be referred back to committee after third sector organisations, trade unions and many, many other stakeholders said the bill was not clear. This has been rejected by the SNP. Presiding Officer, despite the Minister's warm words, the SNP do not seem to be standing up for care in Scotland. In fact, they are standing in the way of care in Scotland, and their stubborn approach to this bill, as is clear in the Stage 1 report, has proved just that. In concluding, Presiding Officer, it is with great regret, for the reasons outlined above, that I will not be supporting the bill in its current form at Stage 1. Thank you.
Thank you. And I call Kevin Stewart to be followed by Gillian Mackay.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. The National Care Service Bill offers us the opportunity to build care services that truly reflect our shared values of dignity, fairness and respect for all people. It gives us a chance to end postcode lotteries, the rationing of care, and should lead to more person-centred care and independence for people. The debate around this bill has concentrated heavily on power, process and pounds. And these are important issues, but the overarching priority of all that we have embarked on has to be people. It has to be people. We need a national care service that leaves no one behind and works relentlessly to support not just those in need of care, but also their families and the care workers who make it all possible. I'll give way to Mr. Balfour.
Jeremy Balfour.
I'm grateful to Mr. Stewart for taking my intervention. What one difference will this bill make to somebody who's in receipt of social care today or tomorrow? What one difference will it make to their lives?
Kevin Stewart.
Make a difference and have a care service that's not only fit for today, but also right for tomorrow. And the Minister, I know, is working in great effort about today. But this is about the future as well. And with an ageing population, we have to make sure that we get this absolutely spot on right. The need for reform of our current care system is undeniable. The disjointed and inconsistent nature of our existing system all too often leaves many without the support they desperately need. This often leads to crisis for folk and their families, which is expensive and also has a massive human cost. Everyone, regardless of postcode, should have equal access to the social and healthcare support networks that they require, with national quality standards that must be met. And this bill presents us with a chance to make that a reality. And at the heart of this bill lies a vision for a more integrated and streamlined service in which resources, standards and expertise are there across Scotland, ensuring greater fairness and accessibility for all. And we need to be focusing on self-directed support, independent living, the right to short-term breaks, Anne's Law and autonomy for frontline staff. However, the focus has been drifting away from this and process and organisation have taken centre stage. These are, of course, important, but we can't become sidetracked as this risks the bill simply becoming a rebranding exercise. This is all about people and their needs, their hopes and their independence. And the needs of people must come before the wishes of the bureaucrats, the politicians, or those with vested interests who do not want to see any change at all. This must be a people-led service and not simply a service that does things to people. And I'm glad that the Minister mentioned that there will be voices of lived experience on the National Care Board. But I would also want to see the voices of lived experience on integrated joint boards too. And I hope that the Minister will tell us more about this in our summing up. Fair work also needs to be at the heart of this change. Care workers must be treated as the professionals that they are. And we know that where they are given autonomy, we get better outcomes for those in receipt of care and their carers. And in a similar light, we need to accept that we rely on that army of unpaid carers who support family and friends. And I recognise that this government has gone further than any other in these islands to support these heroes, but the right to short-term breaks is vital and must be enshrined in law. Presiding officer, at any one time, 1 in 25 Scots will need social care support. Most of us here have had or will need support in the future. And we need a social care system that is not only right for today, but is fit for the future. Now, I recognise, Presiding Officer, that change is often disconcerting, but change is required here. Derek Feely has told us so. Many, many frontline staff have told us so. But most importantly, people have told us so. People who are in receipt of care and their carers, they want to see change, and they want to see change now. This is the most important and ambitious reform that there has been since the formation of the National Health Service, our most valued institution. A National Health Service that came about through a framework bill. So I don't know what the difficulty is with framework bills. It is time that we replicate that valued institution, the NHS, and match it with a national care service that works for people. Presiding Officer, let's stop the dither and delay and get on with creating a national care service that meets the needs of all of our people. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And I call Gillian Mackay to be followed by Jeremy Balfour.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. As a member of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee, I'd like to echo the thanks from my committee colleagues to the clerks and to those who gave evidence to the committee. There is no doubt that there are glaring inequalities across the country in social care. The Independent Review of Adult Social Care outlined significant challenges in the Scottish social care system. The review questioned the effectiveness of local authorities' commissioning practices with a structure based on time rather than outcomes, and one that is not responsive to people's wants and needs. The National Care Service Bill is intended to put human rights at the centre of services. Many have welcomed an opportunity to end the postcode lottery in social care and the establishment of standardised delivery practices across Scotland. There are several aspects of the bill that I think most in this chamber would agree on. We all welcome Anne's Law. We're supportive of the provisions to provide family members or other carers the same access rights as staff. I was very grateful to have met those campaigning for Anne's Law outside Parliament earlier in the bill's progression. Their stories were traumatic, and we should ensure this can never happen again. I have raised previously that while I... Yep, absolutely.
Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Thank you, Julie Mackay. On your point about Anne's Law, when we took evidence at committee around that, but also evidence from people with lived experience, as well as Sam H and the Alliance. So these people all supported getting on with the bill and taking it forward. Is that what your read was when we took evidence from them?
Julie Mackay.
Absolutely, and I thank Emma Harper for raising Sam H in particular, because it was the mental health aspect for a lot of these carers, that trauma of being unable to get to their loved ones, that actually exacerbated some of the want and the need for Anne's Law in the first place. I have raised previously that while I appreciate Anne's Law currently is proposed to only relate to social care settings, given what many, including myself, experienced during the pandemic with loved ones in hospital, this, I believe, should be extended to those settings too. We also all agree on the right to short breaks for carers. This will, however, need to have the appropriate monitoring in place to ensure that it's having the desired effect and is being delivered consistently across the country, and crucially, for all ages of carers. As a co-convener of the cross-party group on carers, we've also heard of the difficulties faced by some in knowing where to go for support and help, or not having been identified as a carer in the first place, and I hope that this is factored into the work that is ongoing on the bill. The general principles of the bill mark a shift in the way that care is considered. We particularly welcome the positive language around the valuation of care, which describes care as an investment in society. The aspirations in the bill, such as recognising that meeting individuals' needs is essential for achieving their human rights, and that fair work principles should be key to the delivery of these services, are essential to change the way that care is currently delivered. We've heard from many organisations and individuals about the appetite many have for change and reform to social care. The bill lays the foundations for a national care service, allowing for a big part of the substantive detail to be co-designed with people who access support, those who deliver it, and unpaid carers. I've been clear in committee that we need to ensure that for those who are involved in the co-design process, that this is done in a sustainable manner. There are a huge number of work streams, and we need to make sure that those who are giving their experience are supported to do so without any detrimental effect on them. Structural reorganisation will only go part of the way to realising the ambition of change and reform in social care. Delivery and implementation of change is vital both locally and nationally to make a real difference to social care. This also will have to be carefully monitored to ensure that it's having the desired outcomes. While framework bills are difficult to scrutinise, I believe this is where one of the potential strengths of the legislation lies: the ability to analyse the impact of reform, then adapt what is in the secondary legislation to improve outcomes, correct any unintended consequences, and adapt to new circumstances. And I believe that this is the right thing to do with appropriate scrutiny mechanisms attached. We must be wary that having a legal duty to collaborate does not in of itself lead to effective collaboration, and much of it relies on consistent leadership and cultures across health and social care, which we've heard is not a reality everywhere. General engagement towards the bill's general principles has been positive. We've heard in committee that there remains concerns about how some of these principles would be achieved in practice. If we want this national care service to be as successful as possible, we must ensure it is viable and addresses the issues flagged at this stage. I welcome the committee's commitment to a more in-depth Stage 2 process and look forward to hearing more evidence from organisations and individuals on any potential changes. Several important stakeholders recommend that the bill passes at this stage, have also been clear that there are substantial amendments that need to be made at Stage 2. The Health and Social Care Alliance, for example, recommend amendments that support the full and equal membership of people with lived experience in reformed IJBs and the National Care Service Board. This would include being given full voting rights and a duty to include multiple lived experience members to be considered core it. I also believe that there should be workforce representation on these boards. There is very little time, presiding officer, to get through everything I would have liked to, but the establishment of a national care service must be informed by the voices of lived experience, including those who access support and care, the workforce and unpaid carers. The National Care Service offers an opportunity to improve people's experiences of rights-based, person-centred social care if implemented in a way that responds to the concerns and experiences of people accessing social care, the workforce, and implements the recommendations of the Independent Review of Adult Social Care.
Thank you. And I call Jeremy Balfour, to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I should declare that I am receipt of social care. In many ways, politics should be about prudence. One philosopher famously said that he prefers the actual to the possible. This is a much better philosophy for conducting our politics than aiming for something that may seem good in principle but would crumble in practice. We owe it to individuals and to carers and the taxpayer to be prudent when making policy, which is why I'm in favour of reforming our current social care system rather than building something completely new. We must acknowledge that the respondents have real concerns about social care, and we have to listen to their lived experience. To diminish these experiences would be very wrong. However, that does not mean the only way forward is wholesale change. We all want a more efficient social care system in Scotland, but the underlying issue will not be addressed by simply structural change alone. We've heard, if you read the consultation responses, that the main difficulties in social care are challenges such as finding suitable funding and hanging on to good staff. These kinds of problems will remain regardless of National Care Service is implemented. And until we address the root issues, it would be much better to target these problems to reform what we have rather than having a complete overhaul. This bill does not honour either those who receive social care or those that work in social care. It lacks essential detail, which makes our jobs very hard, as the policies are impossible to scrutinise properly. Key specifics of this bill rest on secondary legislation, and we cannot know what it will mean for those living their lives today and in the future. For example, there is no explanation of how the bill will affect relationships with existing local care structures, or how a National Care Service could be equipped to respond to local concerns. In addition, areas such as data, employment implications and individual rights and responsibilities are all left completely to secondary legislation. These are hugely important areas that should be addressed in primary legislation to guarantee full parliamentary scrutiny. Securing these details in the primary legislation stage would not diminish the ability to be responsible and flexible during secondary legislation, but it would give us as parliamentarians and those that we represent confidence that the bill had the appropriate power that it required. Social care cannot wait for the National Care Service. There needs to be decisions made now. Social care is too important. The bill as presented is distracting us from solving the real problems we have that people like myself and others with Cross Scotland live with day in and day out. Presiding officer, the bill also does not guarantee meaningful accountability from government ministers. There's no provision for how the principles of the National Care Service will be monitored, evaluated or enforced. Section 2.2 of the bill says, everything that the Scottish ministers do in discharging that duty is to be done in a way that seems to them to best reflect National Care Service principles. So the minister becomes judge and jury. What's even more is effective, successful metrics for success. I am not convinced that a centralised service will provide better care than is currently being offered locally. A centralised body cannot know the exact situation of every community in Scotland. We live in a diverse country with diverse needs. The concerns of care workers and people who need care are very different depending on where you live in the country. It cannot be the same up in the north of Scotland as it is here in the central belt. Those that have rural issues will be different for those of us that represent urban constituents. Presiding officer, there is no value of money for the taxpayer in this bill. The effect of centralising social care is that the organisational and administration costs will balloon and be very much unwieldy than we have currently. The result of this will be a dramatic increase in bureaucracy, which will do nothing for the efficiency and, crucially, will not do anything for those that need the care and for those that provide the care. These funds would be better off going to social care workers on the front line instead of going into a bottomless pit of bureaucracy. Presiding officer, I will not be supporting this bill at stage one. It does not effectively tackle the challenges that currently exist in social care. It's an enabling bill that does not provide the required level of detail to stand up to parliamentary scrutiny. There is no provision in this bill for accountability. It is down to a subjective judgment of government ministers. And of course, this bill does not give the taxpayer value for money. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Colin Smith to be followed by Ruth McGuire.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. A day rarely passed at the height of the COVID pandemic when constituents didn't raise with me their heartbreaking experiences. Not being able to visit loved ones in care homes because we didn't get our act together over testing, social care packages being removed, the pressure people felt to sign do not attempt resuscitate forms, care home staff frightened because they didn't have PPE, and the appalling death rate among those in later life. The human rights of older people were cast aside when the big decisions were being made. Nicola Sturgeon promised to build out of the COVID crisis a positive legacy of a national care service. It was a chance to put social care on the same level as our NHS, to create parity, to ensure services were fully funded, properly staffed, met national standards, but were delivered locally and were accountable to local people. But the Scottish Government have squandered that promise with this bill. We know this government is obsessed by framework bills, or rather, empty frame bills. But even by their standards, this bill is ill-judged, ill-thought through and incoherent. There's been almost universal criticism, Unison, Unite, the RCN, the Royal College of Physicians, so many others who support a national care service but are opposed to this bill. Care providers and those with lived experience, Audit Scotland, COSLA, have all been scathing. So too have this Parliament's committees. The Local Government and Housing Committee called for a full business case before the bill is voted on. It hasn't happened. The Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee said the bill undermines Parliament. The Education, Children and Young People Committee slammed moves to centralise children's services still on the cards. The Finance Committee said the lack of a credible financial memorandum breached their standing orders. And as Jackie Bailey said earlier, they've looked at this bill twice and they still don't believe the numbers. Even the Health and Social Care Committee in its watered-down Stage 1 report is unclear how the government's National Care Service would even operate in practice. No wonder private profiteering from big care home owners, inadequate funding, high vacancy rates, low pay, poor terms and conditions, the absence of sectoral collective bargaining have been all ignored in this bill and were ignored by the Minister today. There's a lack of detail. Big questions remain unanswered. So many issues are unaddressed. Commonweal, in their briefing to MSPs, highlights several glaring examples. Here's just a few. The absence of a clear purpose statement which sets the need for creating a national care service in the first place. No provision for how resources will be determined or allocated. Little clarity on who will be responsible for delivering or enforcing that crucial human rights-based approach. Nothing on transitional arrangements, little on Fair Work principles, including national terms and conditions. Yet despite this, The SNP and Greens, like a 1960 movie, are determined to carry on regardless. Only there's nothing funny about proceeding with a bill today that is so fundamentally flawed. If the government were serious about salvaging this wreck, of building consensus, they would have published their planned amendments before this debate. Yesterday, the bill should have been referred back to committee to revisit stage one, to properly scrutinise those amendments and allow those of us who are not on the committee to debate what may be fundamental changes before we vote on the principles of the bill. Either these amendments don't exist or the government know they won't allay the legitimate concerns. It's not good enough for ministers to slip out an operating model that no one has seen, never mind scrutinised ahead of this debate. Meanwhile, the crisis engulfing our social care continues. Age Scotland wrote to the Cabinet Secretary recently and rightly said, older people in Scotland cannot wait for the delivery of the National Care Service to fix our care system, a system where delayed discharge goes unabated, where people are struggling to get a care assessment, where more and more care homes are closing, one a week, according to Scottish Care, and where older people are left stuck in hospital due to a lack of carers. Ivan McKee said there's about 160 civil servants working on this bill. That's about the same number of vacancies there are in the care sector for home care workers in Dumfries and Galloway. The COVID crisis has been replaced by a care crisis. We need action now, not in 4 years' time, such as on Anne's Law and the right to breaks. The SNP and Greens have cynically chosen to tie people's rights to see loved ones in care homes and the right to respite to this roundly rejected bill. It's simply untrue to argue these can only be delivered through this bill and they should get on with fulfilling their promise to families that were so badly let down during the pandemic. The mishandling of this bill has been a complete distraction from delivering on these and other social care issues, but it is symbolic of the Scottish Government's approach to policy and legislation over the last 16 years. Issue a press release full of hyperbole, dismiss stakeholders' concerns, steamroll through legislation and leave the details until later. The sad thing is that this impacts on people's lives. It means vulnerable members of society, mainly older people who need support, won't get it when they need it. The Scottish Government's so-called National Care Service plans were launched to so much fanfare. They were described as the biggest public sector reform since devolution. Parallels were even drawn with the creation of the NHS after the Second World War. But just saying something in a press release doesn't make it so. When the NHS was created in 1945, that was real public sector reform. It replaced a broken private healthcare system with a universal, free, at the point of delivery, comprehensive service. It had a transformational impact on working people's lives and still does today. The SNP's plans are a pale in comparison. This bill is frankly not worthy of the title a National Care Service.
Thank you. I call Ruth McGuire, the final speaker in the open debate.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The establishment of a National Care Service can be one of the most significant reforms of public services since the creation of the National Health Service. The significance of this work is reflected in the volume and breadth of contributors to the committee's scrutiny, and indeed in the number of briefings colleagues will have received for this debate. I'm really grateful to everyone who continues to share their experience and expertise. I think that it's fair to say that the case for change in social care is unassailable, and everyone agrees that it's necessary. The committee certainly heard that loud and clear. There is a need for all our citizens to have access to consistently high-quality social care support across Scotland whenever they might need it. We all, I'm sure, want our social care workforce to flourish and would support the Scottish Government's goal of future-proofing the social care sector to be realised for generations to come and for people coming into the profession. I've not been a member of the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee for very long, however recognised through both previous work as a local councillor and member of an integrated joint board, through previous and current parliamentary committee work, and perhaps most significantly for me in my current constituency work, the importance for our nation of getting care right and the devastating costs to individuals, families, workers and communities when we don't. We have here in Scotland a brilliant, committed workforce within the public and third sector and a legion of unpaid carers delivering high-quality care to the best of their ability in some terribly difficult situations. We also have pockets of really excellent practice and services which enrich lives. But there are also far too many people whose needs are not being met. Too many people in hospital wards where they should be at home recovering. Too many people waiting for adaptations to their homes to make them safe and enable them to live independently with dignity. And too many people assessed as requiring services and interventions to realise their human rights, but not receiving them because of budget constraints or distance from services or workforce shortages or rigid and flexible approaches from institutions. To change these things, I support the principle of forming a national care service for Scotland to ensure that our citizens get the care they're entitled to live dignified lives, and where public bodies do not meet their obligations, they are held to account. The convener of the committee, Claire Hawkey, laid out well the huge amount of work undertaken by the Health, Social Care and Sport Committee to scrutinise the principle of forming a national care service, and thanked all involved. I echo those thanks. The committee report is lengthy and substantial, with the summary of recommendations alone running to 15 pages. I don't intend to go through them all in this debate. There's been a lot of discussion about scrutiny. Seven committees have reviewed the bill in the 20 months since it was introduced, and the Scottish Government has met thousands of people to discuss the National Care Service. I'm serious about my responsibilities as a parliamentarian, and of course process is important. But I do agree that we'll be letting folk down if we allow ourselves to get too tangled up in procedural delay rather than get on with the important work of scrutiny and amendment to this government legislation. Committee members now have the requested target operating model, and I understand that committee clerks and Scottish Government officials are in the process of discussing stage two amendments to ensure that sufficient time is built into the timetable to allow for scrutiny and further evidence to be taken. I know that every member of the committee will approach that task with the vigour and sincerity that it requires. In closing, I want to acknowledge that the committee were not united in our conclusions, and that the support of members who did not dissent was not unconditional. The report reflects that, and this debate has given us all an opportunity to expand on the personal positions that we hold. Presiding Officer, there is a great deal of work to be done at stage two and three to ensure that this bill achieves its potential. For me, one of the key things will be around accountability. Supporters of a national care service, and perhaps particularly those with lived experience, will want to know what exactly will be different. And as part of that, that the National Care Service will have clear accountability and a fair escalation and redress process for when things do not go right. I hope that should Parliament agree to the general principles this evening, we can all come together and make sure that these important reforms are the best that they can be for the people of Scotland. Presiding Officer.
Thank you. And we move to closing speeches, and I call on Paul Sweeney. Up to 6 minutes, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Minister at the outset of the debate this afternoon said that we need change, and we certainly agree on these benches. But as the GMB Scotland's General Secretary, Louise Gilmore, said, the National Care Service is going nowhere slowly. And as my colleagues before me have set out, it is a matter of sincere regret that Labour will not be able to support the general principles of the National Care Service this afternoon, because indeed a National Care Service has been a long-standing policy position of this party. It was an idea proposed by this party over a decade ago, and indeed it was a matter of consensus that emerged in the wake of the COVID-19 pandemic. As my colleague Mr Smith just said, the parity of esteem between the National Care Service and NHS is a clear mission statement that we can agree with. But as many good ideas, when they reach the hands of the Scottish Government, they seem to go there to die. Providing a universal
Yes, happy to give way.
Kevin Stewart.
I thank Mr Sweeney for giving way. He says that it's with regret that they'll vote against stage one here today. Can I ask him how much engagement he and his colleagues have had with the government around about the National Care Service?
Paul Sweeney.
I can say certainly on the committee that we have tried repeatedly to engage constructively with government ministers, and indeed I believe that carries across two committees in which I've been a member of in recent months, including when the gentleman was a minister in this role. He came before the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee and made the repeated dubious assertion that framework bills were a matter of normal practice, that indeed the National Health Service Bill of 1947 was a framework bill. Well, I'm afraid the Hansard Society disagrees with him, and indeed the National Health Service Scotland Bill of 1947 was around twice the length of this proposed framework bill. So I have to dispute his points on that. And there are critical fundamental issues with it that remain outstanding. Indeed, in an effort to repair relationships, such as the derision with which this current draft legislation has been held by key stakeholders, the government has been trying to run a PR offensive over the last 24 hours. Indeed, I just had sight of a PR statement from the government just published that the National Care Service will provide support to anyone in Scotland who needs it through social work, social care support for carers, primary care and community health services. Then at the end of its press release says that the bill allows Scottish ministers to transfer social care responsibility from local authorities to a new National Care Service. This can include adult and children's services as well as areas such as justice, social work. Scottish ministers also be able to transfer healthcare functions from the NHS to the proposed National Care Service. Well, which is it? We're not getting clarity on this definition, even in the same press release. A comprehensive service, is that what it's been proposed? Or are Scottish ministers still undecided about what will happen with children and justice services and social work and so on? The definition simply is not there. We do not have confidence in this draft legislation at stage one, presiding officer. We hope that the government's National Care Service Bill would provide the transformation that has been alluded to by members on the government side today, but the reality is that the framework bill as published no longer reflects what the bill will become. It is a travesty and it is a usurpation of the parliamentary process. The Conservative spokesman made the point that the Law Society raised concern about the tendency towards skeleton bills, as has the Hansard Society. Indeed, I mentioned earlier the concerns raised by the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee on this very matter, that it risks undermining the role of Parliament. And I noted that Ms Mackay from the Scottish Greens said that the potential is there for flexibility in framework bills, and I note that point, but the reality is that that doesn't preclude us from now, at this stage, defining key aspects of this bill and creating a baseline. It requires ministerial leadership. It requires heft from the government, the mission orientation that we saw from the government of 1945 that built the National Health Service, sadly, sorely lacking 75 years on. That's what we need to see today, presiding officer, yet it has been sorely lacking and it is not good enough. We need to be clear that we take no joy or enthusiasm for not being able to support the bill at stage one, because we've engaged throughout this in good faith, and I'm sure all members of the Health and Social Care and Support Committee can agree that we very reluctantly had to part on that final page of recommendations, but we were largely together on a lot of the substance of this. It was the fact that there were fundamental issues of lack of definition at this stage that was simply not good enough and simply not mature enough to pass Parliament. It's the role of Parliament to stand up for the people of Scotland and ensure the legislation that is passed onto the statute books is of sufficient quality to ensure that people's lives are improved, and that is not what we can have confidence at this stage. There is major issues around the stakeholders, as I mentioned. My colleague Carol Mockin had outlined that in her speech. The SDUC say that the bill as proposed does not address the key issues that undermine the provision of social care. The Royal College of Physicians say serious concern must be given to whether we continue with the current proposals. And the Royal College of Nursing say that we are extremely concerned that they are pushing ahead as it stands and will do nothing to address the current crisis. And the co-design process, much lauded by the government, in which we certainly on the face of it would like to support in good faith, The stakeholders have come back to tell us that that process has had no transparency, no common reference points. The CCPS, the Coalition of Care and Support Providers in Scotland, have said there's no clear connection between what is being heard and what is being delivered in the bill. And I think that was characterised by the speech by the member for Aberdeen Central. Grandiloquent language, but sadly no real substance reflected in the actual text of the bill, which we have interrogated in committee. So that is why, fundamentally, we cannot support this bill, presiding officer, with great reluctance. And I mentioned that in 1947, we had a bill for the National Health Service of 81 sections and 90 pages. This bill, as drafted, of 38 pages and 48 sections, simply falls far too short. I urge parliamentarians to reject it, stage one.
Thank you. And I call on Tess White. Up to 7 minutes, please.
Thank you, presiding officer. I've been a carer myself. No one should underestimate the importance of our social care system for the physical, social and emotional well-being of society. But as we've repeatedly heard this afternoon, social care is at a breaking point under this SNP government, and vulnerable people are on a precipice. As Jeremy Balfour rightly says, social care cannot wait for a national care service. It's too important. In 12 years' time, one in four people will be over the age of 65. That means more people living with complex health and care needs accessing a system that is already in crisis. From staffing levels to care home closures, there simply isn't the capacity to meet growing demand. Of course, reform is needed. The system cannot sustain itself like this, and there is consensus this afternoon around that point. But how that change is going to be achieved is separate, and it's clearly a contentious question. The Feely Review put forward a new approach. The Scottish Conservatives supported many of the report's recommendations, but we do not agree with the top-down concept of centralising social care. We want to see urgent investment in the sector, preserve local democratic accountability through a local care service, and we want to avoid any unnecessary structural reforms. In ordinary circumstances, presiding officer, this would simply be a divergence of policy between political parties. But these aren't ordinary circumstances, far from it. The stage one deadline for the National Care Service Bill has changed four times since the legislation was first introduced in June 2022. The implementation date has been kicked down the road by 3 years, from 2026 to 2029. Spiralling costs show that the government is making it up as you go along. Figures of £2.2 billion and then today £345 million, not to mention the millions spent on the army of civil servants trying to keep the proposals afloat. How can you cost something, presiding officer, if you really don't know what that something is? The goalposts keep changing. As my colleague Liz Smith highlighted, no fewer than four parliamentary committees roundly criticised the first iteration of the framework bill. They pointed to serious issues about the lack of consultation and detail in the bill, significant concerns in relation to the costings, the process set out in the bill being insufficient to allow for appropriate parliamentary scrutiny, and that it risks setting a dangerous precedent, undermining the role of Parliament. Ruth Maguire today called it a can-be. SNP MSP Michelle Thompson said in a meeting of the Finance Committee she had no confidence whatsoever in the level of detail found in the NCS Bill financial memorandum. SNP MSP Kenneth Gibson said introducing the plans were a sledgehammer to crack a nut and a monumental risk. Hardly a ringing endorsement from the SNP backbenches. Last summer, a controversial backroom deal on shared accountability arrangements between the Scottish Government, COSLA and the NHS was supposed to provide greater clarity on the bill. According to the disgraced former Health Secretary Michael Matheson.
Point of order, Michelle Thompson.
Thank you very much, presiding officer, for granting this point of order. I wasn't able to intervene on the speaker today, but I think the record should be accurate. The quote she states me making is correct, but it was at the first financial memorandum, and I want to make clear that, in my opinion, the Scottish Government went away and did a great deal of work on the subsequent financial matters, and therefore it's disingenuous of Tess White to quote in that way.
Thank you, Ms Thompson. I'm sure all members will be aware that the content of members' contributions is not generally a matter for the Chair, and members will be aware too of the mechanism that exists where any inaccuracy exists. Ms
Thank White. You, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased that Michelle Thompson said that was a correct quote. But from the Royal College of Nursing to Unison and many more
Let
besides,
us hear Ms White. Point of order, Kenneth Gibson.
Clearly the member is trying to mislead the chamber. I also made those comments about the first iteration of the financial memorandum, and I think she should be clear about that for the rest of the chamber. Thank you.
Thank you. I will refer back to my previous response, Mr Gibson. Ms White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I wish there was as much clarity in the Stage 1 bill process and scrutiny that is being provided. It does show that my colleagues can actually scrutinise when they need to. But from the Royal College of Nursing to Unison, and many more besides, stakeholders are clear that developments last summer have just breached their trust and muddied the waters even more. Presiding Officer, the National Care Service Bill has been touted by the First Minister as the most ambitious reform of public services since the creation of the NHS. But this has been a masterclass from SNP ministers in how not to legislate. And it's a dog's dinner. The party of the defunct GRR Bill, the delayed deposit return scheme, and the dormant hate crime bill has struck again. Yep. This isn't just about policy, it's about process. And that process is a sham. Today, Gillian Mackay asked Emma Harper about self-directed support. These are just the kind of questions, Presiding Officer, that need to be ironed out in advance of the parliamentary passage of the bill. We're in the extraordinary position of being asked to agree to the general principles of a framework bill that has changed so significantly we don't know what we're voting on. As Ivan McKee pointed out today, it was only yesterday, and he didn't say only, sadly, it was yesterday that a model was shared, and that's a week after the committee finalised its report. If no one is alarmed, they should be, Presiding Officer. It is disrespectful to the parliamentary process. The Health, Social Care and Sport Committee's Stage 1 report is a well-written report, and I think we all agree on that. But as Dr. Sandesh Gulhani emphasised in his own remarks, the SNP Green Majority Committee has ultimately nodded the bill through with too many unanswered questions, as I've outlined two examples. There may be caveats and conditions in the report that support that, but there are no consequences. That is not threshold of scrutiny that the Scottish Conservatives can get behind. You've had your chance and you didn't say anything during the committee process.
Always through the chair, please.
The social care sector is deeply concerned the bill is becoming a battleground.
A point of order.
We cannot lose...
Ms White, point of order, Claire Haughey.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's my understanding of standing orders that members should treat each other with courtesy and should address each other via the chair. Can you confirm that that's correct?
That is the very point that I did just make, Ms Haughey. Ms White.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Pot kettle. The Presiding Officer, the social care sector...
Ms White, sorry, I am aware of... I'm aware of some comments being made. I cannot hear them clearly. I'm aware of comments being responded to. And again, I would just underline the need for all members at all times to treat one another with courtesy and respect and to remember that as we go about our work in this Parliament. Ms White.
Presiding Officer, the social care sector is deeply concerned this bill is becoming a battleground. We cannot lose sight of those people who require care, nor of those people who work so hard to provide it. Ramming legislation through on a wing and a prayer will serve no one, especially the taxpayer who keeps picking up the SNP's legal bills when it eventually and inevitably goes wrong, and including presiding officer. For these reasons, the Scottish Conservatives cannot vote for the general principles of this bill at decision time, and I urge others to do the same. Thank you.
Thank you, and I call on Marie Todd to wind up the debate, and if you could take us to 5 p.m, Minister.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'd like to close this debate by thanking everyone for their contributions. Social care and community health services in Scotland need reform urgently. We know it, our stakeholders know it, and the thousands of people who are impacted by social care who have spoken to us know it. And I believe that all of us in the chamber know that too. While we're working hard to implement changes now, the reality is that we need longer-term, widespread reform to fix some of the issues that are ingrained within the system. People across the country deserve better, and that is what the National Care Service Bill will bring. My colleague Jackie Bailey talked about the bill focusing on the wrong things. She noted culture, support for workforce, eligibility, criteria, etc. Now, I would refer you to the NCS Charter, to the ethical commissioning, and to fair work that are embedded in that. Principles in the bill set out a very clear path. Embedding human rights will address the issues around eligibility and holding people to account for delivering to meet need. On the point of fair work, one of the agreed core functions of the National Care Service is to oversee and to provide assurance on local strategic plans, ethical commissioning strategies, to ensure fair work principles will be applied consistently across the country. Certainly.
Jackie Bailey.
I think the Minister has managed to invite join together all of the trade unions, Unite, the GMB, the STUC, Unison, in a common view. They want all this on the face of the bill. Why won't she do that?
Minister.
So I'm happy to continue to work with the unions on delivering on fair work and to reassure them on what requires what we need to do to deliver fair work, because I agree with the unions. In me, they have a minister who absolutely believes in fair work, who knows the transformation that fair work can bring to our health and social care system, and I'm determined to deliver it. Now, Jackie Bailey also made some criticism of the right to breaks cost estimates, and I'm not sure if she has read the updated NCS bill, financial memorandum, which was submitted in December 23. It sets out cost estimates for the right to breaks that increase gradually over 10 years to between £155 million and £225 million per year. Now, as part of the modelling assumptions that have had to be made because of the level of uncertainty, upper and lower estimates are given. As the demand and the scale of provision is expected to build over time, estimated costs are given for a longer time period than for other aspects of the bill. And officials have been, as one would expect, discussing these estimates with statutory and carer stakeholders to ensure that they are as accurate as possible. Now, Ivan McKee talked about the funding flows through the local government and the NHS. Yes, that is going to be continuing, but we will provide further work on transparency, including potentially independent chairs. We will have national oversight of local strategic plans. We will have direct funding in specific and agreed circumstances only that would apply to things like the real living wage uplifts for commissioned staff, regional and national commissioning of specialist services that will promote transparency of spend within the system. Kevin Stewart is absolutely correct
to talk about the voice, enhancing the voice of lived experience. We've accepted the recommendation from the Feeley Review to voting rights to be given to all public partners, service users, carers, workforce representatives on integration authority boards, and we'll take this forward in secondary legislation, certainly.
Jeremy Balfour.
I'm grateful to the Minister for giving way. We all want to see those with lived experience involved in the whole process. There's no disagreement about that. But why can't that process take place before the bill was introduced? Have the scheme worked out with those with lived experience and then let Parliament scrutinise actual proposals rather than doing it after and when Parliament can't be involved in the process?
Minister.
So, I have heard this plea many times, and I will deal with it in more detail as I move on through my closing speech, but there is no doubt in my mind that we need to act with pace on this issue. People, as we have heard, have been waiting for a very long time without their voices being heard, and I am determined that they will be absolutely central to the development of this bill. Gillian Mackay, I'd like to proceed a little further. Gillian Mackay, as ever, made wise and thoughtful and constructive suggestions. And as always, I will look forward to working with her on the specific issues she raises around Anne's Law in hospital and around the monitoring of implementation on short breaks. That is exactly the sort of thing that the National Care Service Bill could deliver. On Anne's Law, let me reiterate, the Scottish Government is absolutely committed to delivering Anne's Law. Anne's Law fits well into the National Care Service Bill because that bill embeds human rights into our social care system. Uncoupling Anne's Law from the National Care Service would be unlikely to speed up the process for delivery, and it may even mean that it takes longer. Now, of course, we have not waited for the legislation, and we are seeing positive results from having used existing powers to strengthen the health and social care standards and guidance for care homes, thereby laying the foundation of Anne's Law now. And of course, once the NCS Bill has passed and is enacted, we look forward to commencing Anne's Law as fast as possible, as soon as is practically possible, once that is passed, certainly.
Monica Lennon.
I'm very grateful to the Minister for giving way, and I'm glad she's giving so much attention to Anne's Law. I know that Anne's family are listening. Her husband, Campbell Duke, is listening. Her daughter, Natasha, will be listening. And it's actually what they have to say that we all need to listen to. Can I appeal to the Minister that between now and stage two, if that's where we're heading, that time can be made in her diary and with the government to listen to the families like Anne's family and so many others who are not visitors, they are essential caregivers, and that nothing is taken off the table because we all agree in here Anne's Law should be a reality, it's long overdue, and if there's a quicker and more effective route to that, let's not rule it out, Minister.
Minister.
So I can assure the member that I already regularly meet with the care home families, and I must publicly thank Campbell for the beautiful book he gave me, a beautiful tribute to his wife. And if anybody, this legislation is so important to deliver for so many people around Scotland. And I would appeal to absolutely everybody in this chamber to work constructively to deliver it for families like those of Anne, who's absolutely, I listen to them on a very, very regular basis. Their words power me and strengthen me day in, day out in this process. Now, Emma Harper asked us to consider nutritional standards. I'm very happy to do that. There was a question around social work. Social work is a statutorily prescribed role, which involves assessing need, managing risk, promoting and protecting the well-being of individuals and communities. And because of that, social workers is a protected title, with social workers being responsible for the discharging of statutory duties within a complex legal framework.
created to protect the human rights of individuals. Now, the Feeley Review recommended establishing a specific social work agency for oversight of professional development, and that's what we're going to do in partnership with the social work profession.
Minister must conclude. I'm afraid the Minister must conclude.
Okay. So, I am very grateful for everyone's input today. It has been an extensive and thorough stage one, which has been, I think, to our benefit. I have truly listened to the feedback we've had, both from members on all seven committees and, importantly, from the people with lived experience. We have heard from literally thousands of people right across Scotland. The changes I am proposing at stage two, where appropriate, will take account of all that I have heard. And as I said yesterday, far from asking us to slow down, the people who are trying to access social care in Scotland today want us to speed up. This bill is the culmination of significant work, research and evidence gathered over a number of years. Most importantly, it has been shaped by the insight we have gathered from those thousands of people right across Scotland. We know how our current system works and where the improvements can happen. I am proud to have designed a bill that is so directly influenced by the people
you
who
must
will
conclude,
use
Minister.
And work from it.
I must insist that you conclude.
I look forward to seizing this opportunity and to working with cross-party colleagues to deliver.
Thank you. That concludes the debate on the National Care Service Scotland Bill at stage one. It's now time to move on to the next item of business, which is consideration of motion 12093 in the name of Shona Robison on a financial resolution for the National Care Service Scotland Bill. And I call on Marie Todd to move the motion.
Moved.
Thank you, Minister. The question on this motion will be put at decision time. There are two questions to be put as a result of today's business. The first question is that motion 12331 in the name of Marie Todd on National Care Service Scotland Bill at stage one be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The Parliament is not agreed, therefore we'll move to a vote and there'll be a short suspension to allow members to access the digital voting system.